Hey, welcome to Teach.
My title is Itinerant Digital Citizenship and Educational Technology Teacher.
Okay, so that means you have laptop with knowledge and skills and you travel going to...
I am a traveling teacher. I help teachers integrate technologies appropriately.
You have a road show.
Pretty much.
How many campuses do you see?
I'm responsible for 12 high schools. It's not doable, but I do the best I can.
Wow. Yeah. Are there others like you in your school?
There's division? Another one like me who's in elementary. She's got 39 elementary schools. Yeah.
But hey, crazy. If you got Bob Sprankle to sell him on blogging, you know, you do. You've got a good team at your back.
I got my PL. I have to tell you, Wes, you're the first blog I ever followed.
Really?
I'm meeting like Kim Kardashian.
Oh my God!
Are we off on record with that?
Yeah, I turned the recording.
Not only did you
chat live,
not
to
only
YouTube.
Did Tanya admit that Canada is part of the United States, but she just compared Wes Fryer to Kim Kardashian. This is amazing.
How long ago was that when you started reading blogs?
When I was doing my master's in ed tech. You were the first, it was about maybe 4 years ago.
Where were you doing your master's?
I did it at Concordia University in Montreal.
Okay.
And and my professor had mentioned you, and I went on, and it was the first time that I was really, like, exposed to your blog, you were the first blog I subscribed to, and I've been following you literally forever, and, like, I just looked at how many people follow you, I was like, oh my God, I'm meeting Wesley Fryer!
Isn't it interesting when you read someone, I don't know, there's possible, I'm probably like with Bob, too, I mean, I had read stuff he had written for a long time, and you feel like you... can know somebody in a different way. I mean, there's people who I probably see almost weekly that, you know people differently when you read them and they write about their life and things they care about. So it's just, I don't know that I'm articulating this well, but I've had the same experience too when I've met someone who I've been following for a long time and they may not really read me, but anyway, I have a lot of insight into them in a different way.
Yes,
because of the blog and the whole.
The truth is, I've always wanted to work with someone just like you. You know,
oh, you're very kind.
But what I mean by that is, like, I always feel like I'm a lone ranger, and I'm like bringing the good fight, and I'm like, I'm always feeling like nobody gets anything I'm saying, and I'm all alone. So like when I left the GTA, and you can ask Bob, he can attest to this. Like I cried, literally. Like I came home and I cry now because it's so hard to be like the only one.
Right. But isn't it powerful to get to come to an event like the GTA and face to face, you know,
oh
connect
my God.
With other educators?
It is, and I want to do that with everybody. Like I want everyone to experience where we should be and like how we should be heading and like what education really should look like. So like, you know, it's just very hard because I came back and I was like, I felt like I was in the dark ages, you know, and it's like I'm alone and nobody gets me.
So I'm really interested in that whole experience because I've had some like that with the Google Teacher Academy and then Apple has done some things too. What do you think the ingredients were that made that experience? And Bob, maybe you chime in too. And you're about to head to the Google Teacher Summit, right? The Google Education Summit.
Google App in Education Summit, yeah.
What ingredients came together to make that such a powerful experience where you felt so edified and strengthened and inspired and encouraged? Put that into a few sentences and then we'll toss that to Bob
too. Okay, it was meeting like-minded individuals who share the same passion and who view education the way that you view education. And it's not about the technology, like not even for 3 seconds, because the technology was just the tool that we were using. It was about the way we view the learning. I think that would, and I think Bob will probably agree. Like that.
Ditto.
Was,
and Bob, again, the food was incredible.
well, and that's a key deal, right?
No,
how long
teasing.
Have we been gathering
I'm
around
teasing.
Food? No,
but,
it's serious.
But again, you know, we used to be in buildings that you are. I mean, even if I was in a building with all of those people, we don't have time during the day to talk. Mm. You know, we don't have time during the day to go to the bathroom. So, you know, this
we
work...
We didn't, it's true.
This work is done outside. And, you know, getting back to reading the posts, you know, the medium is a message. I mean, certainly the podcast, running or walking with you in my head,
yeah,
or David Warlick in my yes. head, you know, David's talking right to me. I mean, it is an incredible experience. And, you know, I mean, that was where I got my best professional development. I've said that to this day, better than what I got in my master's program was what I got off of blogs and listening to podcasts to and fro work every day for years. And, you know, one person starts talking about something, somebody else will pick that up. It becomes cyclical. And that's exactly what happened to Room 208. Mm-hmm. David Warlick picked them up. Other people started listening in. They had this worldwide group.
Yeah. Good. Well, I've started, it's been about 5 years in Oklahoma, a group called Story Chasers that have been doing oral history projects. And in fact, this summer, Lucy Gray was in Montana this summer and it's beautiful to be in Montana and Wyoming in the summer. A lot cooler there than it is in Oklahoma. Anyway, we're actually going to try and get a meetup together, call it like a Story Chaser Media Camp. And I'm asking about those ingredients because I think it's so important for teachers to have opportunities to bond in that way, but be fed in that way, because I think it can really energize you. And then just it can propel you in different directions with your own teaching and learning and professional development, and just can really be a catalyst for powerful change, more so than a degree program or a formal 100%. Certificate.
Well, it's interesting.
It was like a religious experience. Like, I'm not joking. Yeah. I equated it to the best day of my life after having my children and getting married. Wow. Literally. Like, that's how I felt. And I still feel that way. Like, because I'm not usually in the room with that many people who are so passionate. And I'm not the outcast. I'm not the crazy Tanya's talking. You know, like, I was fit in. I was, like, in a group that of people who really, like, believed in the way that I believe about education.
And you're GTA certified, right?
Right.
Have you found that even just having that in your email, and I have a nice big logo, adds credibility that people really listen to more than many of my other titles? And, you know, Google, you know, I mean... It was worth it just to get that permission to put that in my signature of my email. And I hate to say that. I mean, that's something so small and so...
But to be connected, you know, think about when we were with Marco, you know, a couple years ago. I mean, being able to have a short amount of face-to-face time with somebody and then with the ways that we can be connected digitally, I don't know, the ripple effects of that.
Oh my God, they're my family now.
Being able to be connected, I think that is something that we should try and do more of and find ways is to get passionate educators together and to have FaceTime, and because, I don't know, the ripple effects
My whole goal is what you're facing too, is to get those educators in your school to become as passionate as you are about technology and get them hooked. That is my goal. Like, you have to hook them somehow.
Yeah. Well, I think we start with the students. And I think we've got to get the parents completely on board. And I had a great conversation with two parents about this the other day. And then I think we got to stop walking around the pool and writing books and having the talk and actually take over. You know, revolutionary style or whatever. I know that sounds very political and very, very... very intense, but it's time to take action. There are enough of us. And I think once the parents who have been disenfranchised, I don't know, more or less than the students, once they really are part of, I mean, if they were at GTA, you know, if they were able to have that experience, and that's what I've been trying to pull my PTSA, go to building learning communities. Let's build a fund so that you can go and hear these things that I'm hearing, and you're bringing these back too, not third hand from me, but first hand, and bring, you know, speakers to us as well, which is so easy because, you know, there's so many podcasts and so many webinars and so many things, but they don't know how to access those yet. So we teach them that. And, you know, years ago, last year, a colleague and I were talking about TEDx Portsmouth. And I'm a connector, I'm not an organizer, so I need somebody else to be the organizer. But I think a TEDx based on bringing parents and teachers together to break down that imaginary wall, to break down that curtain, or as thin as it might be, and to collaborate and figure out the best way to do that with everybody having limited time. I mean, we've got parents working three jobs. We've got teachers that are working weekends. You know, we can work together. Race to the top, to me, is a repugnant statement. You know, we should be helping each other to the top. State by state should be boosting each other. We should be showing what is the best. And I think that's what, Bill, I think that's what you're trying to do with this show.
Mm-hmm. Wes, yeah, and you were talking about what I loved in some of the stuff I've learned in looking at your website and talking with you is this idea of play. And encouraging teachers to just play around with this stuff. You know, we were talking about this, you know, just all this, these gadgets.
Right.
And you know, kids love gadgets. Right. I like gadgets. I think a lot of us like gadgets. Not everybody. Some people are intimidated by them.
Right.
But if you can look at them as play, just like, you know, the blogging, if it's a school exercise, it's one thing. But when it's something that you're invested in, mm-hmm. and play's a great way. Is there something to that for the parents? How can we get the parents to enjoy the process their kids clearly enjoy? Any thoughts?
Well, Bob started off by saying we start with the kids and we get the kids. The whole, and I'll go to the Lifelong Kindergarten Group and MIT and the whole Scratch community. I did a couple, helped lead a couple Scratch camps this summer for incoming third through eighth graders. And we had some parents there and some teachers. Their whole model is very developmentally appropriate, where we're introducing some new tools and some skills, we're giving challenges, we're giving time to play, then we come back and share, you know, and then we play some more. Play is not something we tend to think of in school, like even in kindergarten in some places, you're like, get in your rows, mm-hmm. you know, we got to get ready for college. Mm-hmm. We need some encouragement to be able to play, and I'm sure that at the GTA you all had a fun experience with different tools and people who are going to jump in with them and use them. And we need sandboxes where we can safely play with them. I mean, that's something that teachers definitely need. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I definitely am a big proponent, number one, of stopping using jargon. You know, I really don't say podcast anymore. I'm saying radio show.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, narrated art. Let's make narrated art together. Because people know what that is,
yeah.
but podcast, they might not know podcast. What a podcast is.
Yeah, podcast. Yeah. Puts up this big wall.
Still,
like,
yeah,
something
it does. It does. Mm-hmm. This has been an aha for trying to say. And then the other thing is, you know, let's find ways to play with this personally, so that you'll. I mean, what are you giving for Mother's Day next time Mother's Day rolls around? What are you giving for the holidays, for mm-hmm. birthdays, and then media? You know, giving the gift of media, and so. I think that play is essential and helping us become comfortable with it. You know, you've got so many. This is the. I think I'm in a room with more screens than I've ever been in before right now. You know, and you're the master of, you know, these dials, and you were able to, you know, get all that stuff. But, you know, you've obviously played and worked with this for a long time. And so much technology is new. If teachers haven't played, you know, kids yeah. tend to be more jump in, I'm going to figure it out. They're more navigational. Mm-hmm. Older adults can become that way, but I think the role of play is essential in helping us become more comfortable with these tools, but it's also play with a purpose.
Yeah,
I mean, it is fun to play, and that's a good reason to play, but we're also going to play because it's going to open up new doors of opportunity, and it's going to, you know, allow us to learn in some really powerful ways. And it's a lot of times I think we take the wrong approach where we, you know, do some kind of formal presentation and professional development just with the teachers and hope, okay, they're just going to go take off with it. Mm-hmm. And what doesn't happen in many cases are kids, you know, getting to create and getting to build. And that spirit of play and that philosophy can be an important piece of the whole puzzle.
Well, it's needed more than ever. I mean, we need scientists, engineers, mathematicians that are going to save this world, people thinking outside the box and given that permission. You know, clearly, you know, I can't remember how much I talked about the Reim 2-8 reunion already. I've been saying it so much, so stop me if I've said this. But, I mean, those students immediately went out and knew how to set up a safe site by themselves because they had been guided through it. And Tanya's already engaging with them via the Facebook page because she's been invited in. And I just love, you know, that they've already started a conversation. Do you mind if I read their comments back to you?
And they're so smart. The responses that they're giving are so impressive
genius.
To me.
Yeah. They're seniors, juniors, sophomores. And I invited them to this weekend, by the way. If you're in the Portsmouth area, right down the street, I mean, walking distance from where we are, Portsmouth Middle School is an Ed Camp Seacoast. So it's an Edu camp. I don't have the address right now, but
It's on 155 Parrot Ave.
Yeah, and you know, it'd be good if you signed up so they know how much to feed us.
Oh, the website address.
Yeah. Oh that ad. Yeah.
No,
that
I thought you meant the street address.
Yeah, just show up.
It's okay. We make
I'm gonna
that mistake.
Have to go.
It's on my site. Okay. Tanya has
thank
to
you.
Go. Tanya, thank you so
Thanks
much.
Thanks for inviting Tanya. Me in. It's
but I'm
so
gonna
nice
read
to
what
meet you
wrote.
Guys.
Great to meet you. Hang in there. You're not alone.
Thank you. I'll speak soon, and Bob, I'll speak to you soon, okay?
Okay, take care. So
bye.
She already engaged in them, and you know, the important thing, they you know, I woke up Sunday, and there was this page built, and it brought tears to my eyes because they had done everything that we had hoped they would become. They took it over. You want a reunion, Mr. S? We'll do it. They've gotten in touch with all these students I would never be able to get in touch with. They're encouraging them to fill out the forms, and they've built forms, when would be the best time. And so I've invited adults in to start asking them questions, having them thinking, but they're already doing that. I want a very small role in this. In fact, I talked to Elizabeth, one of the students, the other night. I said, I'm not going to post much. And she said, oh, no, Mr. S, people are so excited to be hearing from you. I said, then start some conversations, and I'll be in the comments. But Tanya jumped right in. She said, hi, Room 208. I'm writing for Montreal, Canada. As a teacher, I cannot tell you how amazing I find this. You are truly a remarkable group of students. I have a question for you all. So she's getting them ready already. And the people that have been invited, and you know, if I know you, I will invite you, you know, can get them thinking before the experience happens. I'm wondering, after all these years, how do you think your experiences in Room 208 shape the way you learn? Do you think you would have been a different type of student had you not experienced learning the way you did in Room 208? Looking forward to hearing what you have to say. So Elizabeth immediately said, I would definitely agree with... Well, hold on, I guess Zoe spoke first. I got to open this up. Zoe said, I believe that my experiences with the technology Mr. S exposed us to widened my ability to deal with this technology-based world. Not only did we learn to adapt to new technologies, but we also worked in a collaborative environment similar to many workplaces today. When making the podcast, every student worked intensely on their individual section while aiding and being aided by other students. This environment encouraged creativity, cooperation, and a work ethic that is definitely useful to me today. And then Elizabeth said, I would definitely agree with Zoe. I believe that doing our individual sections also taught us responsibility from an early age. Also, we were more technologically inclined when we got older, even if we weren't completely sure of everything technological going on at the time. It definitely gave us a great base for the future now. Podcasting also gave us great sense of pride and self-achievement, which built up our self-confidence. I think Room 208 has definitely changed who I am today for the better. Now, we don't get to hear that as students of third and fourth graders. I mean, I'm about to start crying because they just defined everything that I wanted to happen for them, you know? And so, you know, I didn't do it. They did it. I made them do it. You know, all the teachers and their parents and the support that they got along the way and that facilitation and that guidance is what paid off. But, you know, they did it. I mean, Elizabeth was the shyest person. She allows me to tell the story. She was the shyest person who came in. And when I proposed podcasting, she was deer in the headlights, afraid. And I took her aside. I said, look, whatever you're ready for. She ended up becoming the leader the next year. And the following year, as a fifth grader, came back and podcasted and interviewed parents at Open House. And I talked to her on the phone the other day, and you know, she sounds like she's running her own business. I mean, it's again going back to changing what we're doing with students, and that is, and it's a scary thing, is letting go of control. And when and to the technology piece is disruptive, you could put a lot of things in. You could bring a pet in as a disruptive tool.
That's right.
And schools have done, as schools have done that, it had great success.
That's right.
A dog in a school. I mean, that you know, a reading dog or whatever. You could bring a lot of things in. Technology makes sense where we're heading, what we need in the world. But it disrupted it where you've given up control. You hand a student an iPod Touch, you just gave over control. Okay, and they're going to take it where they want. I came into Room 208 podcast with all these ideas. Hey, we could have this day in history, blah, 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 blah. They threw them all out in the first 5 minutes and came up with their own corners. And they just have taken it off from there. So I can't wait to hear, you know, from them directly and have it. And so, you know, there are early adopters. David Warlick, if you're listening, get in that blog and start talking to them. Alan November, we actually want you there. You've talked about us enough and used their podcast enough. We want you to come up and you should take them out to dinner. Wes Fryer, you're already engaged and so you're there. And Scott Lockman, if you're listening, he was an early person that students were thrilled when they found out that their podcast was being played in China.
Has the date been set yet, by the way?
The date is to be determined. And I spoke with Elizabeth the other night. And of course, all of this is transparent. I won't talk to a student without talking to a parent, without having them on board. So they have to fill out a form because it's all transparent. You know, keep it safe. So I got to talk to Elizabeth and I said, you know, November, December is kind of crazy. I'm just going to advise you, but what do you think about January? And she said, no, I don't think so, Mr. S. I think the steam will have run out by then. I think November is our time. I'm like, yeah, I think you're right. Okay. You know, I mean, they're calling the shots. So they are on it every day, talking to people, and more and more people are coming. So, you know, we won't have everybody. It would be great if we could. I'd love to turn it into an entire TEDx experience.
What are the sort of questions or topics that are you think this reveals, Bob?
Well,
the,
I mean,
the
of
reunion
course,
of so the yeah. What are some of the themes that this reveals?
I mostly want to be quiet about it because I don't want it to be the Mr. Sprankle show. It never was. Mm-hmm. It never was in any way. And people say, "Oh, you did this. You did this." And the Times came and reported and took interviews from me. It had, you know, I just was crazy enough to spend my Friday nights editing it. I didn't do that in the class because it would have taken too much time. And, you know, I learned a lot from it, and I started my own podcast from it. They taught me things. Students constantly have taught me tricks of the trade that have saved me hours. They constantly do that. So I kind of want to remain silent, but here's what I see it as, and here's why I see it as a monumental moment that I think should really be advertised, and we have time to share this with the web. Which is, here are possibly the youngest students that started with Web 2.0 revolutionary tools, third and fourth graders. I didn't know of anybody. Willowbrook was another school that was podcasting. But other than that, they were the youngest students taking on these tools and doing their own writing and having control. So here they are now, engaging as young adults into their next, you know, they're about to go to college and their next steps. And it's as if they're the cybernauts landing their shuttle and stepping off to report what's happened. I don't know what's happened to them after. I've kept in touch, but I don't know what their technology's experience has been in the other grades. I don't know what they've been doing. Obviously, they're savvy enough to set up a Facebook page, invite me as a host. I don't know how to do that. You know, they're way ahead of me on Facebook. So you know, I want other educators. And today I published on Bit. If you go to bobsfrankel.com/bitbybit. You'll see today's post, which is called Room 208 Comes Home. And there is a form there that any educator can go and fill out and ask a question. I'm keeping that safe. That's for my eyes only so that I can moderate it. But then I'll hand over those questions to the students prior to the event. So anybody in the world can go on today and start asking them questions.
Here's what I'd chime in. I think that what happened with Room 208 and this whole idea of empowering students and letting go of some of that control, a lot of that control, that's so different than what typically happens in education, that there's a lot of great things that come out of that, and people wonder, well, what is that? Well, how did that happen? A lot of the questions that I would love to hear them discuss was, you know, telling that story and explaining, how did you find that experience? How did you find your learning experiences after that? You know, how has that shaped you? Because we're all very steeped in this traditional learning experience. Mm-hmm. Very few kids get to go to be a student with Bob Sprankle or to be in a classroom anywhere where they're empowered in that same way to, you know, discover their voice, write with passion, be very self-directed, truly have an opportunity to help direct where the learning is going in the classroom. Mm-hmm. So I think it's really important for us to amplify that and to share it, because no one has the solution for here's what the school of the future looks like. You know, Bill Gates thinks it's all about Khan Academy and videos, and I think online video is a big part of this blended landscape. But the idea of letting go of control and letting students have a role and using technology to amplify their voices and to encourage agency. I mean, these are very, you know, they're hugely important things instructionally. Mm-hmm. And I just don't think a lot of adults and even kids know about that and have experienced that, or maybe they have, but it hasn't been in a school setting. And so anyway, I just think all of that is what hopefully will get amplified out.
You said it before, but what's the aha moment for you in regard to, you know, when you see something like that, when it works and you go, yeah, and you want to bring somebody mm-hmm. in. I mean, on one level you say, well, they should just get it. Don't you see all it? Right. But What do you tell them? What do you see in it?
Well, I think the aha moment, the light bulb moment, is what we want to have professional development. You talk about getting your teachers on board, but it's different for different people. Everyone's walked down a different road with their own education and their learning. A lot of times, though, it's listening to kids teach and talk. I mean, sometimes that gets our attention much more. I can be an adult up here yapping. Like, sometimes I get to present with my own children. And I see this. I see teachers, adults pay more attention and be tuned in. It's like the frequency. Sometimes kids, and it doesn't always happen, but sometimes they're able to tune to a frequency that connects more when we're talking about some of this stuff. And a lot of it, frankly, is raising our expectations of what kids can do. You know, because I can talk about what kids can do, but when you see kids doing it and you hear them talking about it, mm-hmm. there's a whole different authenticity and validity to what they're saying, because you can't deny it. You know, mm-hmm. you can't say, well, that wouldn't work for third graders. No, this mm-hmm. it is working in this circumstance. It's not, mm-hmm. nothing is going to be a recipe that'll work in every mm-hmm. single situation. But I think hearing from the kids is key.
There is something that does work in every single situation. I believe inherently every human being wants to have purpose, wants to work, wants their work to be meaningful and purposeful, and then have it sustainable. And, you know, that's it. I mean, so you get a class together and you say, okay, class, what is your passion? And they might have to vote on what it's going to be, and it might turn out to be skateboarding. Well, we can approach the Common Core or whatever checklist we're going to have and be thematic about skateboarding. And build skateboard. I mean, think of the math. You know, build skateboards. You know, and what 208 kids told me constantly, they thought they were getting away with something. They were constantly saying, it doesn't feel like school. We cannot wait to get here, mm-hmm. because it was their job. It had meaning. I have a shot that I have permission to use in a presentation. I have to dig it up, but it's the saddest shot. It's a hallway of an eighth grade wing. And it is ankle deep in papers and books on the last day of school. Now, this shows the disrespect to everybody involved. Primarily the student themselves did not respect themselves enough to keep their work. The teacher did not make work that was worth keeping. The janitors are being made to clean up this mess. Obviously, I mean, that picture to me was so profound. that is not what we want. We have tools where we can archive everything, and you know, possibly forever, you know, for a long time at least, you know, till the sun decides. But you know, if those four things are in place, authenticity, purposefulness, meaningfulness, and sustainability, you're going to be excited. You're going to a job. You're going to a work. You count. You know, every student should have their hand shook and looked in their eyes and said, thanks for coming today. And you can, you know, I work at a small school. There are a lot of large schools, but a student could go, I'm sure in many schools, an entire week without one adult talking to them. That should not happen. And so those are things that can be controlled. And again, it's changing what we think of as school. We think of it as teacher-based, where it's student-based. And again, we can still collect the data that we want. Hopefully that turns more into a continuum gathering rather than a grading system. And the students would be taking care of that. And they could, and people laugh at me when I say they can do that right in kindergarten. And I've got some kindergarten teachers that I could refer you to that's exactly what they've been doing. And Google, you know, is a great vehicle for that at this time. There might be better vehicles down the road, but everything can be captured and meaningful. The sad thing was in 2005, this was so new that many parents didn't even have the internet connection to listen to it. And we would record it, but they hadn't heard a lot of the podcast. They had missed a lot of what their work had done. And what I've strived as a teacher all the way throughout is to cut a huge hole in my classroom, look in anytime, see what's happening, because your kids are spending more time with me than you, and that's not fair. So you have the right to know exactly what happens every single day.
Great, great transition there, Bob. You know, cutting a hole or a window in or a fly in the wall, any one of those things, because schools are, to many people, they're sort of mysteries. I mean, I think before I did some arts residencies in elementary ages, what do you do? I mean, how do you fill up the day? And to see it, to see the reality that there's some very specific things that happen in a classroom, and to bring people who are foreign to that experience into it is a real important, I think it's vital these days that we do that.
And there's many issues. There's confidentiality issues of bringing in parents, you know, that have to be trained, you know, because things are going to happen. Mm-hmm. And but, you know, we can on the web, you know, at least show our very best. Why are we not showing mm-hmm. our very best? Early on, I had this conversation with parents the other day. Early on, I stopped publishing my students' work from the bulletin board. We had no bulletin board in the hallway. It all went on the web. And if you looked in the hallway, I thought, uh-oh, we look like we're doing nothing. But the nature of the beast, unfortunately, and this is post 9/11, I hate to say, but our school's locked down. There's nobody's parents are not walking through the hallways looking at this work. Mm-hmm. The only people seeing it are the students, which is great and should happen, and the other teachers. But it almost becomes invisible after a while. You know, you want to showcase this in many ways, many forms. And you know, we did do bulletin boards as well, but that doesn't have the reach of a global audience.
Well, right. We'll keep it. Let's keep this conversation going.
Definitely.
Which it will. As a matter of fact, next week.